Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
I'm Chris. I can
see you. It's perfect. What brought you back to work?
Oh, the book, Barbarian book, Gautier's book. I think it was like 15 years ago that I first personally got to read the script.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a project to Michael Fitzgerald, the producer, for many years.
Mm.
And he has a relationship with John Gautier. And so I suppose that's how I got involved. It's a pretty dark book anyhow. Have you seen the film?
I have.
Yeah. I think the book is about the world of oppression, isn't it? And it's very Kafkaesque, I feel. And it's about colonialism and oppression of indigenous people. So, like, I've been, as a documentary cameraman, I've been, and as a news cameraman, I've been to many places, and that have been in war, conflict, I think that's partly what drew me to the project. It was to find in Curtis's words an expression of and a better understanding. And so when Michael said, "Will you come to do this?" Of course, I had to come because I've been waiting a long time to come.
Yeah.
And yes, as I said, it's about important things. And I also like the Ciro Gira's Embrace of the Serpent film. It meant a lot. I mean, it was a great film.
Is the job exhausting in a way at this age that is prohibitive? Is it, how much harder is it to do your job as you're getting older physically?
I have to say that in Morocco and in the Sahara, and it was just a wonderful experience. The light is so virulent, and the shadow is so dark, and the way the desert blows in the wind, it's just an amazing place to be in to make a film. So I would say it was highly invigorating at my age.
So let's go back to an earlier age. What got you into this in the first place? Were you, I know your dad was an artist, as a music conductor.
Yeah.
But was there something that drew you to the idea of having a camera in your hands and creating the image at an early age?
I was always taking black and white pictures and processing black and white pictures from a young age. Can you imagine Henri Lartigue? What a wonderful child with a camera. That book is such an inspiration. So from early on, and I just fell by great fortune. In London, I met and became apprenticed to an American filmmaker called Alan Forbes, who for like a year and a half taught me sound, camera, picture, light, politics, very impressionable age. And I can imagine if you saw Killing of a Chinese Bookie, that is the kind of experience that I had, because Alan Forbes was making a film in this West End of London, in the centre, about a group of buskers and about their lives and where they live and how they make money and how they perform on the street. And Alan had me for every night, every night except Sunday, for a whole year, take a huge Vortexian tape recorder into a cafe where these folk congregated to record the stories of their lives. Because documentary films at that time were basically, quotes unquote, silent. The sound was always an addition. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until the early 60s that we got the Oricon and the Maisel brothers and that kind of ability to shoot words and record picture.
I didn't actually thought about that. That's like a technological step.
Complete breakthrough.
That changed documentary.
Complete breakthrough. When the Eclair MPR camera came out, it was a revolution. When I shot Kes, I shot it on 35mm with a tiny Arri camera, which was basically the camera that was used in the Second World War by the Germans. And the camera is about this big with a 400-foot mag. We used to put the camera into a blimp. It took two people to lift that blimp. So can you imagine how to be creative with such a huge monster? So technology's done wonderful things. And certainly working on Waiting for the Barbarians, the ability to use the latest Alexa camera from Arri, and shoot a digital image was a wonderful experience. So that's very exciting. So that's where I started with Alan Forbes.
Did you have any resistance to digital cinema as it came up?
No. The first film I shot on what they call Arri Raw was extremely loud and incredibly close. Stephen Daldry's film about kid loses his father. That was shot on that system. I relished it because you have more contrast, you have an interesting use of color. But most importantly, the magazine, because it's not a magazine, but the tape or the digital image recorder can run for more than 50 minutes. In the days of filmmaking, every 400 feet, it was it was another mag. And think about that in terms of performance and actors and directors. It wouldn't be cut, Mark, let's do it again. It would be, and what did you say at the beginning? And so it could go on.
So exciting.
Yeah, very exciting.
So going back to the early days, you were there at the beginning of Loach. You were there at the beginning of Neil Jordan. Frears also. Were you aware when you were making those movies back then that you were part of this this generational shift and this group of filmmakers that would be working at such a high level for so long?
I don't think I was aware. I was just aware of getting a lot of bollockings from various directors. There's a thing Stephen Frears wrote in about If. And the thing is, when we were shooting If, I imagined I was in Paris and I was Roald Coutard's assistant. And that's how I photographed If. that was the inspiration, and of course the great Albert Finney, and of course the great screenplay, and of course Stephen. But I certainly was a part of the French New Wave in Paris when we were doing that movie.
When you came, as you made these movies, because you've mentioned other elements in every movie that you've mentioned so far, were all those things important to you as a, in the choices that you made, or were there choices at that point, or were you just kind of working, or what was your perspective on the business at that point?
I'm sure it is a question of you are working, but I think for instance, on when Stephen asked me to shoot the film Walter, I had the idea, because I've been reading about it, to bring the Steadicam, and we used the Steadicam a lot. And then David Leland, who wrote the Tim Roth film Made in Britain, Alan Clark. Alan Clark saw Stephen's rushes in the cutting room, and he loved the way the camera didn't have to, in a sense, reform. It could just develop with the actors. And so he came to the cutting room, and he saw Walter with Ian McKellen that Stephen was editing, and we'd shot on the Steadicam, and Alan Clark fell completely. So he then asked me to shoot Made in Britain with Tim Roth, which we shot Steadicam. And he was just actually, not diverse, but just, Alan Clark was a great director. Mm. He's a top man.
What is your definition of a great director? What sense do you get when somebody's doing something great?
Well, I think the word's passion. It really is a passion for a story or project. And for me, it's a passion of exploration, political exploration, and it's certain dynamics. And in the writing of Made in Britain, which is finally written and acted by Tim Roth and directed by Alan Clark, there is there's a huge optimism in the storytelling, I think, huge. And that's kind of what I've been drawn to as a person, I suppose.
So you've done a lot of movies. Really, sorry. I
can't really explain it, but you can just say that the experience of Stephen Frears and Walter with the Steadicam led me to work with Alan Clark.
So did working with Loach so much, is that different than work? I mean, a lot of these guys you've worked with two or three, four times, but Loach you've worked, I think, at least six or seven movies, right?
Mm.
Does that change the dynamic of how you work?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I remember when I was operating for Ken and Brian Probyn on Paul Cowell, I remember it was 1965, I think, 66, and the movie had just come out called A Blonde in Love by Miloš Forman, shot by Miroslav Ondarček. And Ken and I, while we were on set on Paul Cowell during a time of waiting for something to happen, we talked about it, and Ken talked about the respect of the way the people in the story were handled, and that's what he really loved. And then shortly afterwards, I got to be apprenticed to Miroslav Ondarček, the man who shot A Blonde in Love, and that, in a way, that was very fortuitous, because 6 months later, Ken asked me if I would photograph Kes, and I could bring so much experience from Miroslav Andrzej Czech on the shooting of If, because I was his assistant on If. I could bring so much of that experience of planning and the way maybe to use light and to use lenses. So I could come to Ken with a bit of kind of knowledge behind the wish. Mm-hmm. And Ken and I then, during the making of Kes, we talked about how the light in the scene would be equal, democratic, and that we would never go within the acting circle. We would never step forward. We would never be there so somebody could trip over the tripod leg. Mm-hmm. We talked about those are things that I guess we liked. So the light would come from the window, but it didn't mean that there weren't significant problems. Like I explained, the size of the blimped camera was like gigantic, taking two people to lift. It didn't solve the problem. If you're only going to light through windows, you need quite a lot of light to bring in if you want it to look natural. So it wasn't without its problems, but I mean, it's such a great book by Barry Hines. I mean, it'd be hard to mess it up, but Ken did it really well.
Well, you're no small part of it.
Yeah, I know, but the governor lets you fire on all cylinders.
So did doing work outside of the UK, was that just somebody wanting to hire you and you went and it happened, or did you make the choice to find another group of filmmakers as well? Because you were really pretty in there in the UK.
Yeah. I wanted to do Killing Fields because I'd spent a year and a half in Burma, cut off with Adrian Carl, chased by the Kuomintang army. And I wanted somehow to exercise or relive or something that experience of being in Southeast Asia in a war situation. So that drew me to that, and then that led on to the mission. So I guess documentaries kind of molded the frame, so to speak.
And your political passions, it sounds like.
Yes, I mean, certainly I'm drawn to the cinema of politics, yeah.
Do you see yourself as having a style or having a thing you bring specifically, or is it a managed job for really engaging the governor and asking what, you know, and serving them exclusively and figuring out how to make that work?
It really depends on the experience, but given the freedom, I for me, it's to it's the passion that comes from the work. It's the passion from absorbing, perhaps remembering. It's if you, I couldn't put a word on it, but there's an inner soul that sometimes your work can really be with a lot of energy. It's hard to explain. It's not always rational, that's for sure.
Well, something like Waiting for the Barbarians is very luxurious and beautiful in how you shot it, as opposed to some of the other work that is more documentary style or, you know, not meant to look quite so, you know, luscious, I guess. That's just a matter of what fit this particular project.
The deserts are very the light and the quality of the light and the quality of the shadow, the kind of the and the energy, and it kind of it's just a most extraordinary experience to work in the desert. It's very exciting. I think the design of the Barbarians very much dictated the visual style. If you imagine a fortified farmhouse on the edge of the desert under those mountains, it's to find a center to go to bind Coetzee's screenplay, to energize it. It doesn't always work, but when it does work, it works really well.
I've been out to that.
The light's just a part of that energy, I think.
I've been out to that studio in Morocco where I think you must have shot part of the movie, where some of the buildings are, no?
No, it's all location. Yeah. It's all in I would describe it as sort of 1860s fortified farmhouse with a wall around it, embellished by Crispin.
So when you, in the middle of all of your work as a DP, you decided to direct at some point.
Yeah.
Was there a reason why you flip that switch at that point?
Well, I've been making documentaries. I'd made 6 documentaries before, produced and directed. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, it was an extension of that. And because I'd worked for Walden Action, they had sent me to Johannesburg during the apartheid period. And we'd also, me and Alex Valentine, the journalist working for Walden Action, we went to Bulawayo in southern Rhodesia in Zimbabwe. And we met up with filming with ANC soldiers who were resting on the border. So when this Sean Slover script arrived about Ruth First and her family, it seemed to be something that I had a lot of passion to work to do. So given the opportunity, I grabbed it.
So it sounds like it was driven more by the opportunity or the film, but the script and the idea, than by your passion to be a director, as opposed to just a cinematographer?
No, I love directing. And I had a passion to do that. Documentaries became difficult because I made a film in Spanish Harlem and in the 80s. And during the filming of that, there were one or two nasty incidents that we directly caused. And that kind of put me off doing documentaries. Because, well, it was like when I was working for Walden Action and we went in with Michael Parkinson in to Zanzibar during the coup. And we landed at the airport. We had to jump. We flew from Dharamsala, Dar es Salaam, and we didn't have permission to land at the airport at Zanzibar. And it was an Australian pilot, and Michael negotiated with him, and he flew us to Zanzibar Island. And what Michael had arranged with the pilot was that as soon as the wheels touched the ground, we would throw the cases and jump. And then he'd take off, which is what he did. Then we got surrounded by three jeeps of very pissed off soldiers and got put in prison. But anyhow, going back to what I was trying to talk about was that when we were eventually released by the Zanzibar Revolution, we were taken to compound. And in the compound, which was barbed wire, there was about, I'm going to guess, 2,000, no, 1,000 men of Arab descent with white beards. And we were taken through the gate, and I was motioned to film because that's why I was there, so get on with it. And as I raised the Bolex camera, the nearest man that I was photographing turned his head away because, like, he didn't want to be filmed, which was fair enough. But the guard next door to me with his rifle hit the man right in the skull, like major damage. And like what I was saying, the reason that I kind of documentaries became difficult was because of when you inadvertently call somebody, like during the film in Spanish Harlem in 1980, inadvertently we cause problems. So that's why I gave them up. Does that answer you? I don't remember what your question was. Yes, so before I directed A World Apart, I had done about 5 documentary films.
And did you want to direct as a primary thing, or were you happy to go back and forth between directing and cinematography?
I'm happy to go between both. I'm even more happy to be inspired by a great script.
So in a film, so you took on some other, there were a different range of filmmakers later in your career. Something like Nikki Caro and North Country, for instance, was that her bringing you in because there was something about your work that she loved? Was it, and obviously the script fits your profile in terms of your political leanings and urges. What was that? How did you end up doing a movie like that?
Falling in love with Charlize. It was a great experience. It was a great experience. It really was. And as you said, it fitted my what I care about. Films, stories that tell, that have a heart.
So she was the first time you worked with her was the first, I can't even speak English, sorry. You worked with her, it was the first time you were working with her. Is there something you know about a director when you meet with them and talk with them about their script where you know that you belong there?
I'm sure you don't always get it right, but the first thing is the script arrives and you read it and you either can't face it or you're completely enveloped in it. So it is part of your story. It's something that you cherish, that you want to fight for. So, and then you meet up with the director and see how it goes.
But is there something is there an energy or an attitude or something about a director that clicks in for you differently than with other people?
It's hard to explain that one. Obviously, they can be magic, and they could not be magic too.
So do you stay away from the not magic ones? Do you make a point of not doing that, or is that a challenge?
I don't think it's kind of plotted and planned. I think the first thing is the script and what the script's saying. And the second thing is the director and what the director's saying. And if somehow you can be a part of that, then that's a wonderful thing, a completely wonderful thing. Creative filmmaking is the biggest buzz in the world. And when it goes, it's wonderful. It doesn't always go.
Are you hard on yourself? You obviously are, but are you very judgmental of your work?
I probably am, but usually the truth is, like on the Barbarians, we had 37 days shooting with that kind of a cast. That's no time at all. Yeah. And but the money is the business, isn't it? So one can not only imagine what the Barbarians would be like if we had 60 days or 47.
Right.
It's you have a passion for a thing, and then you have to face the reality of how to do it.
So you seem very pragmatic about the work, about ultimately that you're there, you do your best thing you can do, you do the most intense work you can do, and then you move on to the next thing?
Yeah, that's true.
Are you much on looking back in general? Do you ever watch your old movies?
No. But we do have possibility now. We've got a big TV screen, so maybe we will.
So would you be curious to see the work that you did all those years ago?
Definitely.
So what do you take away? What is the thing you walk away from when you're done with a project? What is the thing that it was the experience of just doing it that really gets you off? Is that the central theme of your work? Is just getting it done, doing it?
It's hard to put it into words, but I remember on Neil Jordan's film, Michael Collins, I remember on one particular night shoot that it just became perfect how I imagined it. And that doesn't happen often, but it does happen. And isn't it storytelling can be a wonderful thing. And I've had the fortune to work with some great writing and great directors. And it's probably by luck. But it's made for a very creative life that has filled me with more and more passion, not less and less passion. And when the magic happens, there is no greater place to be on earth. So you can't say I left that project behind and I went off and did another one. But you can say that occasionally most wonderful things happen, creative things happen during the making of a story. And that can be a little thing that an actor does, or great thing. And it can be about great writing and sensitive direction. So the many things that add up to make an explosion of goodness.
So the magic of your best experiences is the same kind of magic required to make a great movie. That when a great movie happens, that feeling that an audience has of being somewhere special is the same thing you're feeling on set, it sounds like, happens.
I think so.
It's interesting because your resume is one of the great ones that exists. And yet at the same time, it feels like you have been driven by your passions more than I'm going to be the best cinematographer, or I'm particularly concerned about this particular choice or that particular choice. It seems like you're serving the passion of it all.
Yeah, I think so. Do you remember when you first saw Roberto Rossellini's Rome Open City?
Yes.
And do you remember when you saw some of John Cassavetes' films?
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever see Kathy Come Home?
I don't think so.
Tony Imi, directed by Ken Loach.
I didn't see that one.
It's a great film. The Quatre Cinq Coups. There are some moments in cinema where the passion is awesome. And that's what I love. I love being a part of that care.
When you picked up that camera, has the career or the life or whatever been the thing that you wanted when you first picked up the camera?
I didn't have any expectations.
Too young? Too inexperienced at that point to have expectations?
I didn't have any expectations. I was just doing it.
Has that ever changed for you?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so.
It's still where your heart takes you.
No, I think it's about... So when you read a great novel, it's something... cinema can be exciting.
Yes, but not everybody who's in the middle of it is quite as... has that direction of passion, I guess, it seems like.
Mm. Tell me about the film. What do you think about the film?
I thought it's beautiful. It's obviously well acted. You've got some of the three of the great actors in there, and it's fascinating to watch.
And Mark Rylance, isn't he amazing?
He is it's funny. I saw him on Broadway, a show that I did not want to see a number of years ago. And my sister, who has kind of very broad taste, loved it. And so I had seen everything and I finally went to go see it. And it was one of the greatest performances. It's a silly comedy. I'm forgetting what it's called at the moment, but it was a silly, very broad comedy. And it was one of the greatest performances I've ever seen in my life.
Mm.
And it was that magical moment you talk about with the work, where you're seeing something and you're feeling more, even more than you're supposed to feel. that chill that goes down your back is kind of stunning. Yeah. And Rylance, now I've gone backwards through his work and going forward through his work, it's quite amazing to watch him almost every time.
Mm-hmm.
Stunning performer. But, you know, so are the other guys. They have their moments where you're like, oh. So he has not gotten caught up in the celebrity thing the way the others have.
No.
Which makes it harder to watch their performances, clearly, I think.
Patterson is very good, though, isn't he?
I think he's like the next guy, and he's very down to earth. Also, in real, I've interviewed him a number of times, and very low key, very much about the work. And I think he's special.
Mm, good.
So it's great to watch him. He's actually a surprise in everything, I think, almost. It's like he's become one of those guys. He's not showy, but he is. There's stuff you find in the work that's different.
Mm. Mm.
So will you ever watch the film again now that you've finished it? Even though you have a big TV behind you? Or is it in your head? That is a big TV.
I do. That's what in the back. It's a tiger.
Oh, I can't quite make out the painting. It's very subtle.
It's from India.
Ah, better than a big TV.
Some films, yes, I would definitely love to look at again. I actually saw Made in Britain the other day. I was astounded. It's very exciting. It's funny old man, Alan Clark. No, keep running. But it's been running for 10 minutes. No, keep going. Lovely man. He came to Hollywood. He was going to make Assassination on Embassy Row.
Uh-huh.
Alan Clark was going to do it for one of the studios, a big film.
Uh-huh.
But he died before it happened.
So, do you care for compliments? Do you... When people is it nice to hear nice things, or is kind of like not really relevant to you?
The relevant thing and the important thing is the honest comments. It provokes when it provokes questions, and there's honest comments and the idea. Then it's wonderful to hear absolutely what you think from anybody, the truth, because otherwise you become, you don't move forward, so to speak. So no, I don't want to be complimented. Thanks.
And do you not want to, I mean, when people separate out the cinematography from the movie, it sounds like your work is to not do that.
Yes, you're not supposed to do that, no.
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 So that's...
All I can say is Michael Fitzgerald took me to the Sahara Desert. Am I not supposed to photograph it? Crispian Salas, the designer, and Dominic from Italy, the designers, they found the fort. They should get the praise or the blame as well.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And my job is to try and reflect on acting and on the light and to sustain the day so that the work can be completed. 37 days, north side of the Atlas Mountains in October, November, December, it was, is treacherous because what happens is because it's on that side of the mountain, you have days of great sunshine, amazing energy, and then you have days of cloud and moisture. When you go to the other side of the Atlas Mountains, the south side, the weather's completely different, and that's where we shot the so-called traveling scene. Mm. If it feels different, it feels different because it's the other side of the mountain. And, you know, Cutsy is a great book. And it was an honor to be part of telling that story. I work for the criticism.
So do you have anything else percolating?
No. We're talking about a film in Cuba. But it's early days. Anyhow, we've got a pandemic on.
Yes. So you're having a quiet time of it that way?
I'm having a very quiet time. But a nice time.
Yeah. We're in lockdown here in LA too.
We live in Norfolk. Is it really bad in LA?
Yes, to the point where we don't really understand it, because we thought we were taking care of ourselves pretty well. It's this city. And it turns out the numbers are growing every day here. It's shocking. So it's very scary at the moment.
But it was Thanksgiving, wasn't it?
That was affecting what the numbers are like now, you mean?
Yeah.
Probably. But also I think that I think a lot of the things that people think are not dangerous, because maybe they're not specifically dangerous, the things around them and the kind of comfort we find becomes dangerous. And I think that's part of what's happening also.
Absolutely. And also people don't understand that a room can be infected, so to speak, for at least 3 days after the last occupant left. And I don't think people understand that, do they?
Yeah. Well, I think it's hard. I think there's a weird thing between the sense of protecting yourself and understanding how specific this disease is and how careful you have to be, and this kind of sense of bravado that we all have of wanting to, you know, be part of the world and have other, you know, have all the things that we're used to having, which we all miss. And you think, okay, well, I'm not going to be the one to get it. You know, the odds are 1 in 1,000. I get it. I'm going to, you know, skip around the odds somehow. But people keep on getting surprised, sadly. You know, and it's not just the elderly. People talk about it being, you know, an older person's disease or a sick person's disease. But we know plenty of people, unfortunately, who are, you know, in their 30s and 40s and healthy, who have gotten it as well. So, and have had bad experiences.
And there's also so much talk about the long term.
I mean, people don't even know yet.
Yeah.
No, we're very... I'm afraid this is something we're going to have to get used to going forward in the world.
Yeah. I think you're right.
Well, thank you for making the time this morning and, or this evening for you. And thank you for your work. 'Cause, you know, compliments or not, your films are films that I treasure. And I've probably watched them more than you have at this point, though you shot them. Some of them I've watched over and over and over again. So they're an important part of our history.
Which one?
Killing Fields I watched probably 20 times over the years, amongst others. I'm a big Jordan guy, so I've watched a lot of the Neil Jordan movies repeatedly. And I love Frears as well, though sometimes the later Frears than the earlier Frears. And Loach is always there somewhere nearby. And he's one of the guys who gets play here in the United States. You know, the Loach films, we have Criterion Channel here, which plays his catalog pretty well. Yeah. I love North Country. I was a huge North Country fan from the beginning, because I think it's actually, I think Nicky's kind of a brilliant, underestimated director.
Yeah. Have you seen her new film?
Mulan?
Yeah.
Yeah. Not her favorite work of mine. No. So there's some really incredibly beautiful things in it, and there's some really good messages. But I think in many ways, her ability to take a subject that seems like a stereotype and make it not a stereotype is what I love in her work repeatedly.
Tell me, you haven't really said about this film.
I like it. I can't say that I love it, but I do like it. And I thought it was certainly beautifully made.
Do you think it's slow?
Do I think it's slow?
Yeah.
for this, I think for the current audiences, it is hard. It's a bit of a slog. And that's just how people have become. It's not, the thing is, it's not like French slow. It's not silent slow, which is a different energy. And it's not Hollywood fast.
No.
So it's somewhere in that middle ground that makes it, I think it's tough, a little harder for people, unfortunately.
Mm.
I think people are used to a certain, it's funny, there's a movie on Netflix that's coming out, and the filmmaker was saying how, you know, he's getting negative response to it from people. And I'm like, people, if you had a French name, they would say it was the best film of the year. But the fact that you're an American filmmaker and, you know, from Hollywood, they think you're just making, you know, you're masturbating. It's hard to, the preconceived notions going into film, particularly with critics, I think is a very big challenge.
Hmm.
So
it's really interesting, actually. Really yeah. Interesting.
And I think it's actually worse during the pandemic in a weird way, because we're the range of how we see things is different.
Somebody said to me that the fault with the Barbarians is that our dear producer employed Gautier to write the screenplay, and that in actual fact, not many authors have successfully written screenplays, and that in fact, perhaps that's where the error was. And then when you say, well, what does that mean? Because the film is the book almost entirely.
Mm-hmm.
And they're obviously, they're thinking that the story as is needs to be adapted for a different kind of audience, a cinema audience.
And well, writers fall in love with their darlings.
Yes.
And so if you're a novelist, it is a different muscle group. It's a different, you know, it's amazing to me, some of the best movies, and actually the British directors are often better at it than the American. I've had long conversations with Jim Sheridan about this, but the moments of silence in movies are often the greatest moments. It's not about, it was actually a movie I watched yesterday. And I was frustrated by it because all I really wanted to do was see the star of the movie, not because they were a star, but because they were the lead act, you know, the lead center character. I wanted to see their eyes and their face. Framing it in a different way. So you weren't having their experience. And I desperately just wanted to see the actor work. And they felt they, I think it's a first, in that case, it was a first time director who had adapted the movie from a play, I believe. And they seemed to feel they needed to open it up, when in fact it was kind of the opposite in that case, where you just really wanted to be with that actor and see every expression as much as you could. It's a
Jim, complicated. You mentioned Jim Sheridan. He's the most lovely bloke.
Yes, he is.
I like him and Fran. And their kids too.
Yes.
Lovely, lovely people. It was a great experience doing the boxer.
Great. Jim is the liver. He likes to, he is a live wire, great at the pub, great at the restaurant.
You know, early on, we were talking about directors and finding the magical. Jim is completely alive with magic. The other person who I loved working with was Bill Forsyth. He's a magic man too. Completely wonderful.
Well, actually, maybe I've seen Local Hero more than any of the other movies. Because I've watched that 100 times. I love that movie so much.
Me too.
And then I became friends with Peter Riegert years later.
Yeah, he lives in New York, doesn't he? I met him when I was doing Extremely Loud.
Yeah.
He came around to a coffee shop and it was grand.
Still living on the Upper West Side. Still got an attitude to he's still chasing young girls at 70.
Disgusting.
But he's a good guy.
So, so it's lovely talking to you. If you want to call back or anything, please feel free.
Thank you. Much appreciated. And thank you for the movie, and thank you for all the work, and Have a lovely holiday.
Thank you.
I don't know whether there's any difference between the holidays now and the rest of the year, but because we've all been locked down, but
it's pretty mad.
Yeah.
God bless.
Yes. God bless. Take care.